On behalf of KS Varia Sashtanga Ayurvedics Private Limited, I am privileged and a pleasure to invite you all for this series. We are doing the third webinar and we are going to continue this webinar for some more time. We are a company which was started in 1936. This is the fourth generation that is running. So in four generations, we have seen quite a few patients and quite a few formulations that we have come out with. We produce about 300 products. We have about 6-7 doctors in our panel. We run clinics. We are into manufacturing. So we are into active Ayurveda. So this gives us the privilege to talk about Ayurveda also, I believe. So we are into this webinar series because of that. We want to bring the best of best doctors to talk to you all and clear our doubts and get moving. This is part of a series, so definitely we are going to get more subjects. Today it is going to be a particular subject. The next time it will be a different subject. Each time we will have a fresh doctor coming up and talking to you. So welcome all. Have a nice time. Enjoy. Keep asking questions because questions give life to the speaker. All the very best. Speaker, all the very best.
Thank you.
Over to Girish.
So, thank you, Mr. T. S. Shivarir. So, first of all, I'd like to welcome the speaker of the day. Today, we have a very eminent speaker, Dr. Gayatri S. She is the Prasuti Tantra and Stree Roga Consultant, the Ayurvedic Gynecologic Consultant and Quality Manager at Sarathi Ayurveda Hospital, Alua, Kerala. If you want to look at her profile, Dr. Gayatri S. graduated from SDM Ayurveda College Hassan and post-graduated from SDM Ayurveda College Udupi. She started her career as a specialty consultant and quality manager at Sarathi Ayurvedic Hospital and has achieved considerable results in the treatment of infertility from the very beginning of her career. Her integrated approach and her special in-house preparations, prepared medicines are the unique features of her treatment protocol, especially in infertility management. I am also pleased to say that I have known Dr. Gayatri right from my college days. So I know such an eminent speaker she is. So with that, I would like Dr. Gayatri to take on the stage.
Just a minute, Dr. Girish. I would like to acknowledge the presence of our MD, Mr. TVS Warrior, and our senior most consultant, Dr. TVN Warrior, who is a 1971 pass out. Thank you. Please go on.
Yes, Dr. Gayatri, you may start the session. Take on the stage.
Thank you, Dr. Girish. This has been a privilege to talk about something which is very passionate for me. And thank you for inviting me to speak about this for Ashtanga Ayurvedics. Thank you. Am I audible? Is my presentation seen?
Yes, seen.
Yes, you are audible and you're.
Yeah. So I'll be moving on straight to the topic. Ayurveda, to ensure the health of mother and child is maintained, suggests a comprehensive and holistic regimen, which is nothing but Garbhini Paricharya.
Excuse me, Dr. Gayatri, may put the slide in presentation view because it's a slightly small, the letters are small when we look at it this way.
Okay. How is it now?
Thank you. Thank you so much. Yes.
So a pregnant woman desirous of having a supraja should give up on non-congenial diet and mode of life and try to include a pathya ahara vihara into her daily life. So while talking about Garbhini Paricharya, it includes a lot of things, including ahara, that is the pathya, which she has to follow, the vihara, certain activities which she has to indulge in, the vichara, the psychological state of a Garbhini, garbha upakhata karabhavas, that is anything which can cause hindrance to her pregnancy, which could ultimately lead on to any kind of mishaps, including abortions, and garbhasthapaka dravyas. So, what is the need of, or why is there a need of Garbhini Paricharya in this particular era? So, when we talk about it, we know that in this generation, generally people prefer a smaller family with one or maximum two children. So when they plan for a pregnancy, generally in the mind, they would want a baby who is, or they wouldn't want to take any risk with the pregnancy. So this is the right time. So when they think or when they have a thought about a pregnancy, from there, the care or the involvement of Ayurveda begins. From the preconceptional care up until the delivery of the child, they could include Ayurvedic lifestyle into their daily practice. So it generally helps in ensuring a normal and respectful pregnancy, and it encourages a lady to have a normal birth, and it also ensures that she has a supraja. A supraja is a child with excellent physical health, excellent mental attributes, including the emotional well-being and also intellectual abilities. So we'll be discussing today about the Masonamasika Pathya, including the Samanya Ahara Viharas, which a Garbhini should follow. We'll be discussing about Garbhopakhatakara Bhavas, certain medications which are Garbhastapaka in nature and which are very essential for a normal pregnancy. And we'll also try to talk about certain immunity aspects in the Garbhini, duly considering the pandemic which we are in right now. So we'll straight away go to the Pathya or the importance of Pathya or why there is a need of Pathya. So when we talk about Pathya, we can see in all the text or in all the scriptures and wherever the references is found, very clearly Acharya Kashyapa has told that Yadanna Panam Prayana Garbhini Stri Nishevate, and whatever rasa or ahara rasa which she is taking is utilized in three areas. That is for the Madhra Pushti, the mother's nutrition, for the Garbha Pushti, for the nutrition of the Garbha or the fetus, and also the formation of the Stana. And there is also a context in which Kashyapa has clearly told that it also helps in the formation of Stanya, that is the breast milk. So this is the main area where Ahara Rasa or Ahara comes into place. It helps in the development of the Garbhini, the health of the Garbhini, the development of the fetus, as well as the formation of the breast milk. So moving on to the Samanya Ahara Viharas, there are certain things I will not be dwelling too much in detail into it, because everywhere in each trimester, again, it is explained very detailed. So in the Samanya Ahara Vihara area, everywhere we could see that they have concentrated on the Varjana of Apathyahara. That is, a lady should start including Pathyahara Viharas into her diet. She should start taking Hridya Padarthas. So, and they have specifically mentioned Madhura Praya and Snigdha. There is, throughout the pregnancy, we will see the involvement of Madhura Praya Snigdha, because as they are Vata balancing in nature, so it helps in the maintaining the normal Vata in the body, because it is already known that throughout the pregnancy, there is always a chance of Vata Vyadhis or Vata Vishiation. So for balancing that Vata, most of the diet which we include would be Madhura predominant and Snigdha. Madhura, because it is more anabolic in nature. We'll be talking about it in detail. So he has also mentioned that you have to process it with Deepaniya Dravyas. Why Deepaniya Dravyas specifically? Because this is a time where the digestive power or the digestive capacity of the pregnant lady will be hampered due to the involvement of progesterone hormone, which is predominantly the pregnancy hormone. And also, as the abdomen is growing, it could put a pressure over the peritoneal organs. So this could create a situation where there is a digestive compromise. So using Deepaniya Dravyas helps in improving your digestion. thus including and they certain dravyas like shundhi, which we use as a deepaniya dravya, or maricha, which we use as deepaniya dravyas, are very good immunoboosters as well. Moving on, they have also told Garbhani is ideal for Brahmana therapy. That is, she can gain how much ever weight she wants. She can have whatever she wants. That is what is indicated from Brahmana therapy. And they have also mentioned or emphasized on the importance of Jivaniya Gana Ushadhas and the importance of Navaneda, Ghrita and Kshira. That is butter, ghee and milk, which will be discussed in detail in the further slides. But again, Acharya Kashyapa, being a Bala Chikilsaka, has focused on why she, or the while we give a specific diet, we should consider the desha which the Garbhani is in, the place where she is in, the season in which she is in, and also the digestive capacity of the mother before prescribing or before suggesting any particular diet for a Garbhani. There is also importance given for Ishnodagna. Excuse me. It could be because there are chances that with Ushnodaga, the digestion could be improved. It can prevent infections from happening. So there comes the importance of Ushnodaga. Again, about Kshira and Mamsa, we'll be discussing in detail in further slides. By Surana. Surana is yam, which is a tuber, which is constipated in nature, but a very good medicine for hemorrhoids as well. So the pregnancy is a time when a lady could develop hemorrhoids like features. So including Surana in her diet is an ideal choice. Moving on, there are certain food items discussed in detail like Shali, Shashtika, which are Brihi Dhanyas, like rice, particular varieties of rice, which has got that husk in it. And green grams, wheat, broken rice, butter, ghee, milk, and certain preparations with curd, honey. These kind of things are very commonly used throughout the pregnancy. Moving on to the Samanya Viharas. Shuchi Alankrita, that is certain activities or certain practices which she should indulge in. These are called as Vihara. So, she should be shuchi means she should be pious, both externally and internally. She should be pure. It comes about in the form of hygiene as well. But while speaking about internal shuchi, it could be the faith or devotion or the purity in which she is keeping her mind in, or the balance of state in which she is keeping her mind in. Then coming to Shukla Vasana, going for dull colored or white colored clothes. Why white colored clothes? It is a proven statement that white colored clothes or dull colored clothes are better in absorbing sun rays, which is essential for the bone growth, and it is a good source of a lot of vitamins. So maybe because of that, they have emphasized on Shukla Vasana. Then there is also importance given to a faith or devotion. Throughout various textbooks, we have seen that you should give for do Shanti Mangala, do Devata Priya procedures. All these are for a mental well-being. And also, this is not fixated to any particular religion. Irrespective of the religion, they could follow their practices. But there are certain mantras, especially chanting. To quote a few examples, I would say, chanting Omkara, influence of Gayatri Mantra, or maybe Vishnu Sahasranama has been seen to be very positively affecting the fetus. So that could also be a cause why these things are practiced. Then the Garbhini should be sitting in a comfortable posture. Why in a comfortable posture? Because that is necessary. She should always be sitting in a soft mattress, soft cushions. The headrest should always be high. She shouldn't be sitting in any uncomfortable postures, sitting in a very higher radius. These things can be avoided. And moving on, coming to the use of Jivaniya Gana Dravyas, earlier it was told it can be taken internally. It can also be used externally as Dhara or maybe for snana, etc. And mostly the lepana of kasturi, chandana, agaru kind of drugs, that is musks, I've mentioned in the slides, as you all can see, cooling agents can be used, and priyashlesha or manorama vikaras could be practiced. These are all the viharas which show support to the pregnant lady from the family members as well, keeping her mental state in a much better area. Moving on to the Garbhini Snana, there are certain drugs specifically mentioned which are good for the snana, from which the Vardhakna leaves, that is the leaves of drugs like Eranda, Nirgundi, etc. could be used, make kashaya out of it and have snana with these water, which could pacify the vata, which is ideal during pregnancy. Now we'll be discussing each trimester in detail and why these food is discussed in each month. Moving on from the first month. In the first month, usually the diet is mainly milk. Milk is what is explained throughout. And there is involvement of madhura. Madhura as in sweet taste, sweet rasa pradhana drugs. Shita, that which is cooling in nature, and dravapraya, mostly liquid in nature. So these are the food items which are mostly discussed during the first month. So, but again, Acharya Charaka has very specifically told that considering the digestive capacity of the woman, we should use it. She can have it very frequently in smaller amount. And there is also a controversy of Anupaskrita Kshira and Upasamskrita Kshira. Anupaskrita Kshira is the milk which is not processed with any medicines. And Upasamskrita Kshira is you can use some medicines to process the milk and have it. Both the ways it can work, because both the acharyas have told it could be used in both ways. But Vagbhada has not mentioned what sort of drug has to be used for processing the milk. So Madhura, predominantly Madhura rasa dravyas are used. So we could take that. And again, immediately after your sexual intercourse, when you are kind of expecting a baby, you can go for the initial 12 days, you can start having ghee prepared out of milk and a diet predominantly, as I said earlier, Madhura Shita and Dravapraya. So if we, there are chances of Garbhasthapana because of it. So maybe that's why they have told you can use it in the initial 12 months. Moving on to the second month. The milk processed with Madhura Dravyas are usually told. But Acharya Harita has specifically told you can process with Madhura Dravyas and Kakoli as well. In the third month again, milk is there along with honey and ghee. But Acharya Shushruta, he has told that in the first 3 months you can go for sweet and cold liquid diet, but including that, you can also have Shashti Kaudana with paya, that is rice with milk, which we commonly use in the household as palkani. These kind of preparations can be used in the third month. And Acharya Harita has added Krishara. Krishara is a combination like khichdi, which is very easy for the digesting. These kind of preparations have been discussed in the first trimester. And Pumsavana, which is a highly misunderstood technique, which has got a lot of benefits, and it is ideal to use it in the to do the Pumsavana Karma in the first trimester. What is Pumsavana Karma and why is Pumsavana Karma done? Actually, Pumsavana Karma can be done for a person who wants to have or a couple who wants to have a pregnancy. They can also do Pumsavana generating the implantation, or for the Garbhasthapana purpose also Pumsavana can be done. And again, for having a child with your preferred sex, for that also this Pumsavana Karma can be done. But only the third point is highlighted mostly. But we'll be discussing about the Garbhasthapana qualities of Pumsavana Karma, the ideal time to do it, etc. it is ideal to do it within 2 months. Most of the drugs used in the Pumsavana Karma are either Vata Pitta Shamaka or Brahmana. So these drugs are very good for Garbhasthapana. Sthapana, as in it could help in preventing the abortion, and also it helps in maintaining the healthy pregnancy. The procedure, although internal intake is also being practiced, it's generally considered to be done as Nasya. The probable mode of actions could be, it might be improving or facilitating the implantation by helping in the formation of decidua, and also it helps in the formation of placenta. So generally, as it is given in the Nasya form, the probable target organs of Pumsavana could be the hypothalamus, that is the center, the master gland, and again the fallopian tubes and endometrium. So, benefits of the diet which we use in the first trimester. The early weeks of pregnancy, everybody would be knowing, that is the time when the morning sickness pops up. So the nausea happens, the vomiting, whatever you have, you vomited out. Having solid food itself is a great difficulty during that time. And then again, that is a time when the frequency of micturition is more. So either way, there are chances of developing dehydration during the first trimester. So what the food items which predominantly being used in the first trimester is Sheeta Drava Praya, that is cool and liquid diet, which is kind of easy to digest, more palatable, and it is not gastric irritant, and it prevents dehydration as well. Then coming on to the Madhura Dravyas, including the milk, there we can observe that they are more anabolic in nature, that is strengthening. So it maintains the health of the mother as well as the fetus. So even if she is vomiting everything out, if we are making her have a little bit of it, little bit of kshira or a little bit of milk itself is enough for a day actually. So that can provide her with the adequate nutrition. Again, milk is also a very good calcium supplement. And the snigdha aharas helps in balancing the vata. And the shashtika shali with the paya is a very good nutritive. It has got a lot of nutrition. And it is a very good diet, which is good for balancing the doshas, and it is snigdha, laghu, grahi. So there is nowhere a chance you are giving for vata to vitiate. Moving on to the second trimester. And I would also like to add certain tips which you could give during the time when you're having a lot of vomiting, and which there are certain household tips like, for example, laja, that is the broken rice. If it is mixed with water and add sugar into it, and you can have it. You can prepare porridge, that is the kanyi out of this laja, and you can have it. You can have a lot of tender coconut water. You can have coriander water mixed with a little sugar. Then you can have pomegranate juice. These things helps with the nausea and vomiting, which usually they feel or experience. Then having a lot of liquid diet can also cause a sort of vomiting. Like practically when you see, these things can happen. So giving some solids in between, like a ball of dry fruits mixed with some powder of nuts, and all, like if you give a ball out of it and you can have it, that creates a sense of fullness. So that helps. These kind of things do help. And there are certain homemade kashaya preparations which you could use with the help of tender coconut, tender mango leaves with your green gram, and add a little coriander and ginger into it. You can prepare a small kashaya out of it, which is again very good for the digestion, and it prevents this nauseating feeling. There are certain other drugs also, like again, with the pomegranate juice, you can add a little bit of honey and sugar. With you can take bilva mula, laja, and again ginger, and you can make a kashaya out of it. You can take any, whatever is available among the things I have discussed. You can take that and try making kashayam out of it and use it when you are when you see someone having this complaints. In the second trimester, This is the time when the lady starts, the morning sickness is almost over. So she can have whatever she feels like having. This is the time when the Dauhrda thing pops up. So she will start having these cravings, which should be fulfilled. And these kind of things come in between. And this is also the time, considering the fetus well-being, this is the time when the indriya starts developing. This is the time when the brain starts developing. The mind development starts happening. The muscle development starts happening. So this is the time, the diet, which is included in the second trimester, as we see now, is mainly medhya in nature. That is, it helps in a lot of brain development, muscle development, and helps a lot with the digestion. It helps in that way. So we'll see what we usually give during the second trimester. We'll be giving Navanita in Akshamatra. Akshamatra is one Aksha would be approximately 12 grams. So Navanita, Kshira Navanita is the butter prepared out of milk. This could be given. And this is the time when Acharya Shushruta will bring Jangala Mamsarasa into the picture. Jangala Mamsarasa is the soup of the animal meat of dry areas. The animals which resides in the dry areas, that they are relatively lighter in nature. So these Mamsarasas could be included in her diet. Then comes Shashti Kaudana Vidadi. That is your rice with curd. All of the people love that combination. So that is a very good, it has got high nutritive values. That is being included in the second trimester. Then again, milk, butter, these are the common food items which we'll be having. Then again, ghee prepared out of milk. And that is told by all Acharyas in the fifth month. And also Shashtika Shali with milk, Hridya food, which that is more palatable, or the things which the Garbhini feels like having with Jangala Mamsarasa. And sweet dishes like payasa, things can be included. And again, the ghee prepared out of milk should be processed with certain Madhura Dravyas in the sixth month. These can be taken. And the Gokshura drug, either processed with ghee, or you can prepare a porridge, mix it with the churna or the powder of Gokshura, and you can have it. Acharya Harita has asked to take curd mixed with sugar. Now we'll be dealing with all the specific diets and the properties of these diets. So as I've said earlier, this is the time when the fetal skin starts developing. See, there is this beautiful simile told for the development of the skin. How the cream is formed from the milk, in the same way from the rakta, the skin will be formed for the fetus. So Navanita, which is Sangrahi in nature, that is, creates a kind of constipative nature, and it is also Bala, Varna and Agnikrit. So that Bala and Varna could be beneficial for the formation of skin, for bringing about a good healthy skin using the butter will be highly beneficial. And again, it is very good for the digestion, because digestion complaints, gastric complaints will be present throughout the pregnancy. So this is helpful in that way also. It is Brahmana in nature. It contains a lot of omega acids. So that maybe that's why it has a role in preventing the congenital anomalies which could develop in the fetus. Then again, it is good with the acidity. It is high in calories. So if you have a little of butter itself, you are intaking a lot of calories at the same time. And speaking of rice with curd, this is a combination which is very essential for the brain development, because it is a proven study that curd rice is very good for the brain development. So in that way also, this is a time when the brain development is happening in the fetus. So it could be acting in that way too. And moving on to the Jangala Mamsarasa, it is Garbhadana, that is, it helps in the pregnancy. It is Pushtikara, because this is the time when they need a lot of protein for the muscle development and everything. So these kind of Jangala Mamsarasa is a very good source of protein. And it also helps with the absorption of iron. Iron content is also there in the mamsa. And pregnancy is a time when the lady could have anemic kind of features. So it helps in that way also. And when you see regarding the, if you talk about it in an Ayurvedic way, this is a Samanya Siddhanta happening. That is for the mamsa development, having mamsa is. In a similar way, that could also work. And when you talk about Sarpi, this is the time when ghee, the use of ghee actually starts happening in the second trimester. So Sarpi is something which is Satmiya, that is, which is inherent and which is already good for the body since the birth. It is very good for developing the ghee. Ghee is like the memory aspect or the intellect aspect of the child, or maybe with the mother, the digestive capacity of the mother. Everything could be helped with Sarpi. It is yoga vahi nature. So if we add another drug and process the ghee, it is in improving the quality of the drug as well. So it is kind of a miracle drug in during the pregnancy. And I would also say it has the capacity to cross the blood-brain barrier, as it is very sukshma. So in that way also, it could be affecting the brain development of the fetus. It is very good in preventing the intrauterine growth retardation. It is a good source of linoleic acid, which is again an immunobooster. It has got butyric acid, which helps again with the brain development. So by the end of the second trimester, if you see, then that is the time when the edema starts happening. That is the swelling in the feet, the water retention. There are chances for someone, they could develop hypertension related to pregnancy during this time. So the presence of gokshura, which is mentioned earlier, it is a very good diuretic. It helps with swelling. It helps with water retention. So that way also it could be working. And there are other medicines or food which we could use, like maybe the leaves of shigru, the drumstick leaves, which is very good in maintaining the hypertension. Then by the end of the third trimester or throughout the third trimester, there is this Amaranthus spinosus, Tanduliya, which is called in Sanskrit. It is also called as Mullanjeera in Malayalam, which is very good for your dietary purpose. So that way also it helps. And Yavagu Pana is told in second trimester, which is again a very good Balya supplement. It is good for the Tarpana purpose. So in that way also it helps. In the third trimester, when we move on to the third trimester, this is the time when more of ghee is there. Ghee is still there in the picture, but a lot of procedures starts popping up in the third trimester. Then again, there are a certain specific group of drugs which are used to prepare with the ghee, and it is used for intake in the third trimester. So in the seventh month, you can see that Sarpi, the ghee prepared out of kshira processed with Madhura Ushada is given. There is this particular Prithakparnyadi group of drugs processed with ghee and taken. And then again, in the eighth month, you can see a lot of Yavagu, which is Snigdha in nature again. Yavagu, which is mixed with a lot of ghee. That is, as you see, it's more of a Brahmana in nature. And in the eighth month, Acharya Shushruta has asked to go for Asthapanavasti, which is good for Purana Malashodhana. Purana Malashodhana is whatever fecal matter is remaining, it helps in the elimination of that fecal matter. And again, then he has told to take Snigdha Yavagu with Mamsarasa up until she delivers. So this is the same procedure which happens in the ninth month also. And while moving on to the ninth month, everywhere it is told you can the practice of Anuvasanavasti and Pichu. And he has also asked to take Ashtanga Hridayakara along with Anuvasanavasti and Pichu. There is a presence of Snigdha Mamsarasa Udana and Bahusneha Yavagu, which is quite similar to what the other acharyas have been telling. So the benefits of these diets is, when you see, it is highly nutritive, because up until the second trimester, the fetal growth will be kind of in a lesser pace. It will be growing very slowly. But as you go on to the third trimester, the growth will be fast. So once the baby starts taking everything away from the mother, there are chances of emaciation in the mother, like a lot of tiredness pops in. There is a loss of strength which is happening. So when the mother takes a lot of these kind of food, she can equally distribute within her and the fetus. So that helps. And it is also very good for improving the digestive power. And as you see, all of the food items are very amtas in nature, very snigdha in nature. So it is, even though not directly, it is helping in her preparation for the natural birth. And the Pritha Parnyadi groups, as you have seen here, they are diuretics. They are good anabolic drug. Then they are galactagogues. Galactagogues, it is very good for the formation of the breast milk, because it is this time when we have to think about, as she will be delivering in any moment, there are chances of her lactation is going to happen soon. So these things has to be also kept in mind while giving the diet. So now moving on to the general diet, whatever things which we could see in our kitchen and try to take from the kitchen and have, like a lot of legumes, pulses, beans, groundnuts, these kind of things can be used, as they are the vegan source of protein. And a lot of people who don't prefer to have meat, they can have this. And it is also, the absorption is also much better. And then there is sprouted beans, where your green grams, the kadala thing is not very ideal because it can cause a lot of gastric irritation. So ideally green gram, but you shouldn't take it raw. You should always cook it and have. And then comes milk and egg. So in pregnancy, a pregnant lady needs, apart from her usual diet, she would need an extra of 300 kilocalories in pregnancy. So having a glass of milk, an egg and a banana is done. She'll have that 300 kilocalories from it. It can also come from her biscuits or any junk she has, but the nutritive value is much better here. So I would recommend to have milk, egg and bananas. And as you see, you can have lots of fruits, because this is the time when there is a chance. There are two main things which she could face during a pregnancy. That is, first thing is constipation, and the next thing is there are chances of anemia popping in. So fruits like banana, lot of vegetables which are fibrous in nature, green leaves, all this helps in relieving her of the constipation. And the Indian gooseberry, that is arnelika, and this pomegranate, and again the green leaves are also very good source of source to improve her blood count. So it helps in case of that as well. So these kind of things can be included in her diet. And to prevent the gastric irritations, it's always good to have tender coconut water, large asaktu, a lot. Now, moving on to the food items which you should avoid. And that includes Ati Guru, Ati Tikshna and Madhakara Aharas. Ati Guru as in very high food digestion. Ati Tikshna, Aushadhi is mostly. And Madhakara, which cause Madha. So that includes recreational drugs, alcohol. As we all know, there are a spectrum of diseases which could happen due to alcoholic nature in the mother. So it's better to avoid. And Aditarpana, Atikarshana, Shushka, Paryushita Ahara. Aditarpana and Atikarshana will be discussed later. Shushka and Paryushita. They are Shushka means dry. Paryushita means again rough kind of things. Because these could vitiate Vata, which is not very ideal in the Garbhavastha. Then comes Vishtambi Bhojana, Madhya and Amisha. Vishtambi Bhojanas are something which is not very ideal. It could produce kleda, which is not very good for your gut or the digestive system. It could produce some sort of heaviness or burning sensation in the chest, etc. And madhya, I have discussed earlier. Amisha is meat. Maybe what he's trying to imply is not to use a lot of meat. And again, anupamamsa is not much indicated during the pregnancy, because they are pretty heavy. So maybe that's why. And there are other things like vidalanna, vidahi ahara, Vidahi is again which produces some sort of irritation or burning sensation in the chest. Guru Ahara, which is difficult for digestion. Amla Ahara, because Ekarasa Abhyasa, again, one Rasa Abhyasa is generally not indicated in Ayurveda. In pregnancy also it is not indicated. And they have specifically told Amla Rasa could cause certain skin issues in the fetus. So it is better to avoid Amla. And Ushnakshira, Mrittika, that is mud is not ideal. Garlic and onion, maybe because they cause some sort of digestive irritation. So these things are not indicated in pregnancy. So among the things which we see in our kitchen, what we should avoid. You shouldn't be taking a lot of masala food and fried food items during pregnancy. See, if you're craving for it, you can have a little bit of it. But ideally, it is good not to use it much. And refined flour. Why not refined flour? Refined flours could cause constipation. So maybe because of that, it is not good to have refined flour. Then stale food, old food and refrigerated food is not ideal. It's always better to prepare fresh food and have. Then it is better not to use tea and coffee and aerated drinks as they're not good for the health. And this is, you will get an ample of amount of time, that is 9 months. So, and if you make a habit of it, you can leave it in the future as well. And then like vegetables like cabbage, fruits like papaya and pineapple and sharkara, that is the household guda, is not indicated during pregnancy. And if you are having a tendency, you have a family history of diabetes mellitus, it is better to avoid sugar. Otherwise, also in limited quantities only, sugar is indicated. In hypertension prone people, it is better to avoid salt, better to avoid butter and ghee. You can have milk, but without the cream. Now, there are a lot of procedures which is explained in regard to the last portions of the or the last trimester of the pregnancy. That is, first of all, from the 5th month, it is ideal to have oil massage and then go for a medium warm water snana. Because in 5th month, it is better to just apply the oil over the abdomen, the back areas, the legs, etc. And by 7th month, you can use it throughout the body. The ideal oils would be balataila or dhanvantara taila. But if they have a lot of pain or aches in any specific areas, there you can apply murivenna, or depending on the area, you can prescribe whatever oil is needed, and you can give a small steam, not a big one, small with the cloth, you can give a small sveda. That is also ideal. While speaking about the vasti and pichudharanas are the major procedures, none of the other shodhanas are indicated during pregnancy apart from vasti. So vasti helps in the removal of retained fecal matter, and it is very good in Vata Lunlopana. So that is why vasti is given. Both Asthapana Vasti and Anuvasana Vastis are done. But in the place where I studied, we used to do Asthapana Vastis. But we have observed, if not done in very strict observation, there are certain complications which could come out of Asthapana Vasti. We have done study on it as well. But Anuvasana Vasti, we used to do it for all the pregnant ladies in the OP, and it has shown innumerable results. It helps a lot with the normal birth as well. So how it should be affecting? It might be affecting in a way, that is, it could be affecting the autonomous nervous system governing their myometrium for regulating the function during labor. So that's how it could be working when you have to scientifically prove it. Coming on to the Pichudharana is nothing but vaginal pichus, which are autoclaved and kept, which is done very strictly under aseptic precautions. And you should not do the pichu if you find any sort of infections, because there are chances that those infections could ascendingly spread. So you should be very, very, very careful while giving the pichus. But it could be helping the vaginal flora by killing off the pathogenic bacteria and further preventing the puerperal sepsis. It is also, it makes the perineum very soft in preparing the apatyapatha, as you say, the vaginal pathway for the delivery. And there is a similar effect when you keep the pichu. We ask them to keep the pichu for at least 2.5 to 3 hours. So keeping it for that longer duration might be helping or facilitating some way for the upcoming labor. Now, moving on to the garbhopakhata garbhavas, we can club it under three headings, like the certain activities which brings about psychological and physical strain, like shoka, bhaya, that is immense amount of grief, fear, lot of vyayama and vyavaya, that is exercise and coital act during pregnancy, and visiting places which could bring shock. For example, what they have mentioned is cremation ground, overweight lifting and carrying or traveling in uneven roads, which could increase the intra-abdominal pressure and causing abortion-like features. And overeating, kind of dietary restrictions. Like overeating could lead to an overweight in the fetus, which could give rise to a very difficult labor. That is one thing. And again, there are a lot of chances of fetal compromise when the weight increases. And then there is again karshana, that is atikarshana or fasting. Fasting is not at all indicated during pregnancy, as it could again lead to some electrolyte imbalance, or a prolonged amount of fasting could affect the fetus as well. And it also leads to vata vritti. Moving on to the garbhasthapana dravyas, the names are already given. I would just say these dravyas are garbhasthapana in nature. So ideally, it could be helpful in preventing the abortions, according to the tika, Hindu tika of Ashtangradaya. And Kashyapa has specifically told that it is very good for maintaining the proper health of the mother and fetus. But the drugs which he has mentioned is slightly different from the usual drugs. But still, Jeevaniya Gana Dravyas are also good Garbhasthapaka Dravyas. According to Arogya Kalpadrimam and Sahasra Yogam, there are certain single drugs which are very commonly used throughout the pregnancy in the form of Kshira Kashayas, which is very good for the health and for the maintaining a healthy pregnancy. So Kshira medium, as you all know, it is anabolic. It is going to be very strengthening. That is one thing. And it is also very good to have them. That is, in the first month, Bala is given, which is a very good, which is a Garbhasthapaka Dravyas, or according to the Charaka Gana also. It is very good for the sthapana of Garbha. And it could be, it is one that drug which could be used throughout the pregnancy. So even if you are starting your Kshirapakas in the fifth month or fourth month, it is ideal to start with Bala and then go for the other drugs. All these drugs are good immunoboosters, very good with antidiabetics, very good for preventing hypertension. And it is a very good nutritive source, prevents constipation. So all of them have got greater benefits in regard to the pregnancy. And there are certain groups of drugs which are very good for threatened abortions and for people who has had histories of recurrent abortions. That also I've mentioned here. Due to time constraint, I'm not going to explain all of them in detail. But there are, these drugs are very beneficial for a lady who has had threatened abortion. Threatened abortion is, there is a beginning of abortion, but the abortion has not actually happened. So we can prevent it. And also habitual abortions. That is, she have had histories of abortions previously. And for preventing that abortion in this particular pregnancy also, you could use this. By Garbhani Paricharya. Garbhani Paricharya is mainly help the Garbhini in the Kukshikati, Parshva and Prishta Pradesha, that is in the abdominal area, the back and the thighs and everywhere. It brings about a kind of mridutva or softness. It helps in Vadanulomana. It helps in the proper evacuation of Mutra and Purisha, and also Jarayu Marga, is that is the placental removal also during the time of the delivery. And it helps in giving a child who is Ayushmanta, who has longevity, and who is of good bala, etc. So to conclude, the diets and regimens which are described thousands of years ago in the classical text of Ayurveda for pregnancy is totally scientific and are specific to fetus and mother. And this aims at the excellence in the formation of the fetus, its development without anomalies, and to secure a full-term delivery and maintain the health and fetus, the health of the fetus and the mother. Thank you. I know you can ask doubts if there is some confusion, because I have not explained everything due to the time constraint. This is a huge topic which could take a longer time to finish off, but still, yeah, you can go on with the doubts.
Yes, Dr. Gayatri. So thank you for the talk you have given us. I think we have a lot of interested people with a lot of questions. So may I go to the question answer session? I will read out the questions which are there in the chat box, as well as some doctors have sent me the questions in the in my WhatsApp account also. So shall I transfer the questions to you one by one?
Yes.
Thank you, Doctor. So the first question is, how effective is Pumsavanam in getting desired sex of progeny?
That is not there are a lot of controversies regarding that particular thing, because within the 2 months or within 2 to 3 months, actually the sex determination of the fetus has already happened. So while giving Pumsavana solely for this purpose, I do not know how far it is going to affect. It could also lead to some sort of mishaps, like, certain mishaps, which is better avoided. I would not recommend Pumsavana specifically for sex of a child.
That's an ideal answer, Dr. Gayatri. Thank you so much. The next question is, how effective is Ayurvedic contraceptives will work in 21st century? So is it 100% effective is the query.
The I had mentioned earlier, it was practiced as an abortive efficient also. That is Mullanjeera, Tanduliya drug, which I have mentioned earlier. Because there are certain drugs which affect well, but I do not know how far they have people are practicing it, because this is a very holistic science where these kind of practices are not very appreciated or regarded in that manner, I feel. So, and if some complicate, but there are, I feel the chances of complications due to this is much lesser.
Yes, doctor. So the next question is, just like in allopathy, menstrual pain relievers, similar medicines in Ayurveda will work instantly?
Yes, there are certain drugs like Ponkaryadigudiga, for example, which works very well. And there are certain home remedies like tea and all, which we usually prepare at home, which could work very well regarding the pain. Unless if there is a certain pathological, organic pelvic pathology associated with the pelvic pain, if there is nothing of that sort, it will work amazingly well, like a painkiller itself.
Yes, doctor. The next question is, best effective yoga since Shushka Yoni?
Yeah. Your Kegels exercise is very good. In the same way, you could practice the Shalabhasana, and also the Baddha Konasana kind of practices are very good for Shushka Yoni. Bahya Pranayamas are also ideal.
Okay. The next question is, COVID-19. Okay, it is related to COVID-19 present situation. COVID-19 will transfer from mother to fetus during pregnancy. Does it transfer like that? Is the question.
Actually, according to the WHO, I have read the most latest is the news which have come yesterday. There is a case in France in the third trimester of pregnancy. When the baby was born, in the third trimester, mostly the baby have contracted coronavirus in the womb from the mother, because the placenta is showing a higher viral load. So It is the rarest of rarest scene because it doesn't happen very often, because previously whatever pregnancies which has happened, there was no transmission, or the vertical transmission was not happening. But yesterday there was a case reported in France where the baby was COVID positive. So we cannot say that it cannot be transmitted through the during the pregnancy through the placenta. There is a case which says this has happened, but it is very rare.
Yes, doctor. So I have a few questions in my WhatsApp also. Some of them have sent me. The first question is diet on infertility. Even though many couples are having both physical and mental normalcy report and without any history of family infertility, they are subjected to infertility by unknown reasons. So their diet, medication, any treatment if recommended, what are they?
Shodhana is ideal, because either way there could be some reasons. A lot of investigations has to be done again, but doing a shodhana could help with improving the quality of the ovum as well as the sperm. So if there is no other issue with this, and maybe a small counseling regarding the positional aspect of the coitus or the fertile period, or some sort of counseling is also highly beneficial, because some people would be kind of ignorant in many of the areas, especially regarding the fertility. So counseling them as a couple would be ideal, I feel. And also a course of shodhana and some medications which are naturally fertility improving can also help.
Okay. Any specific medications for vasti, Astapana and Anuvasana is the next question.
Anuvasana vasti, I would say Dhanvantara Taila is an ideal drug. And then Sukhaprasava Krita, there is a preparation which is also good. Urvaruga Krita, it is a product of Vaidyaratna. That is also good. And for Astapana vasti, it is a combination of a lot of drugs in terms of kalka and all. It is a big preparation. So, and it has got complications also. So, Anuvasana Vasti is something which we can practice for every pregnant lady. And these are the drugs which are usually used.
Okay. So, I have a question based on the liker of the pregnant lady. So, there are two questions in that. So, one question is, in case of some conditions like oligohydroamnios, what is the line of treatment? And the next question is, what are the diet recommended for less amniotic fluid cases as well?
Oligohydroamnios the same. So, yeah. So, in conditions of, while talking about the medicine, Shatavari Kshirapaka is very ideal if the fluid is really less. And again, talking about the food, you can have a lot of fluid diet, which are more of Brahmana in nature, like tender coconut water, milk, for example. All these things can be taken. That is how in case of food we can maintain. But in the medicine, Shatavari Kshirapaka is an ideal drug. It has shown great results.
Okay. The next question is, Guda is rich in iron, right? Then why to avoid Guda?
Guda is, you see, it can cause uterine contractions. Premature contractions. Okay. So using a lot of Guda can cause these kind of features. So maybe because of that, it is told not to.
Treatment for hydrosulfings is Stadia, Asadia, or Yapia?
Yapia, I would say, because there are certain areas where Uttaravasti and all has shown great results. But in some people with the same Uttaravasti, the situations has worsened also. So it is a controversial thing. But initially giving a good, I would say, for a Pitta Shamaka Dravyas like Gulkulu Tiktaka Kashayam, etc. In the initial phase, and then going for certain Sthanika Chigilsas would be ideal.
Okay. During gestational diabetes, what type of food and medicine can we suggest?
Yeah, the food should be of minimum, there should be no sugar at all. And in case of milk also, it should be without the cream. But apart from that, the other food items she can use, like for example, the ghrita, like the ghee and all, she can use, which is what told here. But in regard to the, if she is having fruits, because there will be a lot of restrictions with the fruits. So she, the fruits which she can have is ideally pomegranate, guava, apple, that kind of fruits she can have, but banana and all she cannot have.
What are the medications prescribed for habitual abortion?
Yeah. For habitual abortions, there are certain simple things which we can do, like in the initial stage when the pregnancy is confirmed, up until the full trimester, she can go for the intake of phalaghrita, which is very good, and it prevents, it is very good for habitual abortion. It brings about garbhasthapana, which is very nice, and there are certain combinations, but the kshirakashayas, which I have told, like bala, lakshmana, these kind of drugs are also very good for garbhasthapana. For recurrent abortions, also this can be taken.
Okay, the next question is how TORCH positive patients will be benefited with Ayurveda in attaining pregnancy? TORCH infections. So how, yeah, TORCH patients, the patients will be benefited?
So initially after the her TORCH treatment also, she'll have to go for an initial, the usual protocol like Deepana Pachana and some sort of the, whatever toxins has been accumulated should be thrown out with the Shodhana therapy. And then if she achieves a conception happens, these Garbhini Paricharya mat will help her.
Okay. Is there a specific prescription for or aushadha to be given for the baby from the time of Karna Vedana, like Vacha with gold, etc.?
Vacha with gold can be given from Karna. Maybe there are in certain areas, there is a practice of giving it from birth itself. But yeah, it is ideal to give it. And in the Kerala, as a local practice, we do give Oryamarindu. I do not know what it is called. In there are tablets available for Oryamarindu now. Otherwise, they are a bunch of drugs which I can share later if anybody is interested. This, that is very good for the colic and the issues with the digestion for the baby. That is practiced from a very early stage itself, this Oryamarindu practice.
Is there a specific, how do we manage ectopic pregnancy in Ayurveda?
Once the pregnancy is terminated, we can, depending on the month in which the termination has happened, usually it will happen between 7 weeks itself. So after that, whatever care we give to our sutika, apart from the milk part, whatever care we give to the sutika, that is regarding the diet or maybe whatever we give as the external treatments can be given. But if she has, this abortion has happened in the second month, for 2 days is ideal. But people do it for 1 week, 2 weeks. That is also okay.
Okay. So, menorrhagia, best effective treatment for 50 years old patient?
There could be a lot of reasons for a 15-year-old to have menorrhagia. That is
50, 50, 50.
Oh, okay. That, there also, it could be a process nearing to the menopause. There could be a change in the hormones, which could lead to menorrhagia. But it is always better to go get a checkup done. That is, a pap smear test is the ideal thing which she has to do nearing the menopause. So that is, it is good if she could do that and then go for the treatment. There is effective treatment management for menorrhagia during menopause.
Okay, doctor. There is a question on cravings. What about the unusual cravings? Like if the mother is addicted to junk food, should such cravings be encouraged?
Yeah, Dauhrida should be encouraged, actually. So what happens is, if she's craving for junk food, you can, if she's craving for Lay's, for example, you can give her one piece, two piece maybe, for just to like to subside that craving for the moment, and then focus on the nutrition afterwards. Yeah, because you shouldn't hurt her feelings. So that way it works.
Okay. Foods that increase amniotic fluid, they are asking for examples. And Manasika Chikitsa for a mother during last trimester will work effectively or not?
Doctor, can you shift your camera a little? You are half hidden. Ah, that's good. Thank you.
Yeah. So, what were you asking?
Food that increases amniotic fluid. And the second question is, Manasika Chikitsa for mother during last trimester will work or not?
The food items I've told earlier. There is no specific food items as such to increase the amniotic fluid. But use of milk, tender coconut, etc. It will help in some, like to an extent it will help. But there is no food as such, because these are not, you eat it and the fluid will increase. It is not like that. It doesn't work like that. So, fluid intake is the best option. The tender coconut, milk, and any sort of juices for that matter will help. That is for the amniotic fluid. What was the other question? Am I not very clear?
Manasika Chikitsa for a mother during the last trimester.
Okay. Manasika Chikitsa, Chikitsa, I did not understand what they mean by Chikitsa. What sort of Chikitsa?
I don't think the person is asking for any disease-oriented Chikitsa. I think it is just Manasika counseling. I might include that counseling, I guess.
Look, see, usually, not just in the last trimester, there is a time when she should be well educated about the labor, what is going to happen, how she should be prepared. Because otherwise, once the delivery happens, she will be in a dilemma, like what should I do? It is a hectic thing, actually. People feel that women are born to be mothers, but it is not like that. They will be like in a confusion, like what they should do or how they should handle the baby. Or there are plenty of doubts. And if the family isn't very supportive, she will naturally, this is a situation when she will have these baby blues and then postpartum depression kind of things pops up. So it is always, these kind of things will have an effect. Like she will, the support and the love you show will naturally be benefited. And you will only be benefited. Like whoever is giving the support, because that the support which she gets is very helpful. Yeah.
Foods that will increase milk for mothers.
Shatavari helps in increasing the milk, and uluva. You know uluva. I don't know what it is called in English. It is very good actually.
Fenugreek.
Fenugreek is very good. That is a very good source. And like preparing kanni, etc. with fenugreek, it helps. Then using drumstick leaves is very good. Jeeraka is very good. Yeah, all these are very good sources to increase breast milk.
Okay. So are there any diet and regimen which should be followed for normal vaginal delivery? And is there any replacement in Ayurveda for vaccination during pregnancy?
Vaccination, there is no replacement as such. You have to have vaccinations, because TT vaccinations are the only vaccinations which you're taking in pregnancy. That is very important, because if by any chance you need an intervention in the hospital, like for example, a cesarean or this episiotomy, So there you are using these instruments where you would need all of the, or they are, they use aseptic precautions, all are sterilized instruments, but still these, this is a basic protocol that they should follow. If any infections happen, there are chances of infections happening out of these interventions. So for that, to prevent that, TT is important. So I don't think you should replace, there is no replacements for TT injections. And
okay, doctor. I think you are, yeah, tell me.
What was the other question?
The other question was diet and regimen followed for normal vaginal delivery rather than having any.
All these regimens I have explained have a role in natural birth. So there is the other thing which we should keep in mind is the Vasti and Pichu has a role. Then staying active, which I did not mention earlier. Staying active is very, very important. Walking is the best thing you can do. Unless, like, every pregnancy is different. So unless you, there is a doctor instruction that you should have a complete bed rest. If there is nothing like that, you should be active. Like doing exercises, going for walks, these kind of things help a lot for natural birth. That is the only option you have. Because if you are sitting ideally throughout the 9 months, there is no way you can have a natural birth. It is very difficult to have a natural birth if you don't you stay ideal and sedentary. Yeah.
Yes, doctor. Meat is not contraindicated in pregnancy. If so, how long can a pregnant lady have meat?
Meat is you can have meat. I told no. Sushruta is telling you can have meat from 4th month itself. You can have meat, but it shouldn't be deep fried. It shouldn't be with lot of masala. It shouldn't be like that. If it is bland, like soups, you can have. And if she is too craving for it too much, you can have a bit of in the other way too. But you can have meat. But see, the quality of the meat and all is important. For example, if you go for chicken, you please go for the ones which are not with the antibiotics and everything. Go for the normal, like, what do you say? Organic meat.
Not the curry.
Yeah.
Okay. So there is one question. If Garbhini feels like having oily and fried foods, is it going to hurt the pregnancy? So I think you have already answered that. In small quantities, for taste purpose, they can be given, I feel so. Is it right, doctor?
Yes.
Okay. And in Ayurveda, can we know about congenital anomalies before the birth of the baby? Can Ayurveda predict it?
No. You have to go for sonographies. In the 20th week, you'll get to know. There is an important scan which no one should miss. It is in the 20th week anomaly scan. There you would know if there is any sort of anomalies. But there are certain medications which if they get to know that there is some sort of an anomaly, there are some preparations which can minimize the risk of anomalies. Yeah.
Can we prevent lifestyle diseases to pass on to the baby when there is a presence of diabetes or hypertension in the mother and father's family?
If there is a positive history, there is always a chance of baby having it. So the baby's lifestyle should be improved. Then she will not have the disease. Like, that is how it works. Because you also know, like, that's how it works. Because from the baby to the mother, nothing will go, it is nothing. There will be a genetical chance of having it. But if the child is adamant that I should not get it, and if he is following a good lifestyle and everything, he will not have it. Unless, yeah, he will not have it.
Okay. I think with that, I come to the end of the question and answer session. I would like to inform everybody, those who have not registered, to please register. I have put forth the link in the chat box. So you can register to get the certificate. We'll be providing you a certificate for attending this webinar. I would also like to thank Dr. Gayatri for her time and for all the patience she had for talking with us. It was a great session, Dr. Gayatri. I think all of us in Ashtanga agree with that, and all the people who have come here for the talk also have involved so much with so many questions. That shows that everybody has been involved, and we have all have loved your webinar today. So I would, from Ashtanga side, I would like to thank you, Dr. Gayatri, for giving us your time.
And thank you so much. With deep gratitude, thank you so much for inviting me. And please excuse my cloth.
I would also go ahead and say that you are very courageous in answering all those questions that were put forward.
Thank you so much, sir.
So I think with that, we can come to an end end of this session. Please note down, everybody, those who have not registered, you may please register. I have put forth the link in the chat box so that you may not miss the chance of getting a certificate for this talk. And also those who would like to contact Dr. Gayatri. Dr. Gayatri, please, can you put forth your email ID inside this chat box?
Yeah.
Or you can tell me, I can type it down. We can all note it down.
It has come. It has come.
Okay, yeah. So,
you may all...
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
I remind you all again to please register for getting your certificates. So, with that, we come to the end of this session. Thank you so much, Dr. Gayatri, again. Thank you all.
She has left you.